Hi all, thanks for tuning in. I started this video wanting to talk about Vega only, but the most important point that I wanted to talk about, without background context, its significance was lost. I feel that in order to fully appreciate the evolution of graphics technologies, we have to delve into the past to learn about the foundation of modern GPUs and importantly, why key decisions were made. ATI slash AMD and NVIDIA share such a rich and competitive history that it's really impossible to talk about one without covering the other as well. As such, this will be a two-part series. This video will explore the recent strategies from both companies, and the later will cover Vega specifically. If you are well aware of the histories of both AMD and NVIDIA's architectures, you can skip this one. Otherwise, stay and I'll try to make it as interesting as possible. A major truth in engineering is that it's all about compromises because there are definite constraints, either physically in terms of production capabilities and or economically as profits are a major factor. How this relates to the semiconductor industry revolves around two main constraints, chip or die size and power usage. We've all heard of the terms jack of all trades, master of none. Applied to GPUs, the different focus can be summed up as graphics and general compute performance. All else being equal, if you design a GPU that's great at graphics only or great at compute only, you can get away with a smaller and less power-hungry chip for the same level of performance compared to a GPU that attempts to be great at both tasks. Now, if the size or power limits determines how big or power-hungry a chip can be, a focused chip will therefore have high performance because it is more efficient in terms of performance per millimeter square and performance per watt. Some of you at this point would already have jumped to a conclusion about Vega, but it's not that simple. Remember the all else being equal part. I'll go into it more later. But for now, let's go back to 2006 when the world of computing changed forever with NVIDIA's G80 architecture, the first true general-purpose GPU. Prior to G80, GPUs were all about being a 3D accelerator with limited capability of running programmable vertex and pixel shaders. G80 was made to break this limitation by redesigning the stream processors, later renamed CUDA cores, to be able to process common math operations, which decoupled the GPU from being a graphics accelerator into a general maths accelerator with graphics function. Of course, this came with a major cost in increased complexity, resulting in G80 being a very large chip by standards back then. Usually, making a larger, inefficient chip is not a wise decision for profits, but NVIDIA was betting that they can sell these chips for supercomputing markets for 10 times the price, and this will more than compensate for lower yields or production costs. Except there were no such market at the time. NVIDIA saw the growth of big data centers. The boom of supercomputing era was driven by CPUs such as IBM, Xeons, and Opterons. These relatively small CPUs were being sold for massive prices, and NVIDIA wanted that slice of money. To penetrate this market, an easy-to-use language was required to take advantage of the GPU's parallel stream processors, and they invested to develop CUDA. Needless to say, the result is CUDA and G80 Teslas were very well received by the high-performance computing market. With this success, NVIDIA went all-in on compute with the next architecture, the GT200. It was even bigger and one of the largest GPU ever, even by today's standards. During this time, AMD were on the Terascale or Very Long Instruction Word 5 architecture. It was purely designed to be as efficient as possible at graphics workloads. The stream processors in Terascale were less complex, but there were more of them, and individually they could process up to 5 simple instructions each, and for graphics workload with its parallel simple instructions, it was, and still is, a very efficient architecture for gaming. These two different approaches collided with the GT200-based GTX 280, versus the RV770-based Radeon 4870. Both of these GPUs traded blows in many games, but the 4870 was half the size and at a much lower price, forcing major price cuts from NVIDIA. This situation intensified when AMD released the first DirectX 11 capable GPU in 2009, with the Radeon 5870 based on the Evergreen architecture. It was very much a continuation of the Terascale architecture, just more of everything and on a new 14-nanometer node, which at the time was problematic for the foundry TSMC. Because NVIDIA was still in the all-in mode for HPC, they went with a huge design for GF100 or Fermi, and this amplified yield issues at TSMC. The result was the GTX 480 was late, and when it finally came, it ended up barely beating the 5870 despite being an expensive and massively larger and more power-hungry chip. However, none of this mattered, because while AMD could compete and sold a lot of discrete GPUs during this time frame, they were not making much profit undercutting NVIDIA to force a price war on a market that's the major source of revenue. NVIDIA, meanwhile, was banking big time on Quadros and Teslas, using their compute-focused architecture to generate the profits during a period where AMD decimated their GTX margins. Under a normal scenario, AMD's highly efficient graphics architecture over several generations would have sunk their competitor, but NVIDIA kept on making profits, and this allowed them to increase the R&D while AMD was downsizing due to the failing CPU business. Ultimately, AMD lost this battle because they barely broke even despite being so efficient at graphics, and this was the last straw for AMD's management. From here onwards, a different approach would be required, a grounds-up new architecture to compete against NVIDIA's high-performance computing market. AMD shifted their effort to this next-gen architecture, so the following generation, the 6970 based on the Cayman architecture, was simply a quick and dirty revision until the real next-gen was done. This was of course the Radeon 7970 based on the Tahiti chip and a new graphics core next architecture. The effect was immediate. In a wide range of compute workloads, Tahiti was revolutionary compared to AMD's prior designs. Some of the features which made GCNXL a general purpose compute includes a dynamic hardware scheduler, low latency atomics, register layout, data share between SIMs and compute units, fast context switching, async compute, and finally high performance throughput without requiring instruction-level parallelism. It was a generally well-received GPU, but its moment in the sun was short-lived. While AMD pushed towards a compute-focused architecture, NVIDIA took a sharp detour after the experience with Fermi to focus instead on efficiency. The result is the Kepler architecture, debuting with the GK104 chip powering the GTX 680 GPU. Kepler is a simplified and refined Fermi which sacrificed a lot of compute flexibility but compensated by having many more smaller CUDA cores, which meant that it excelled in graphics workload relative to Fermi. The major changes in Kepler that improved its efficiency was a shift to a hybrid software and hardware scheduler, CUDA cores designed only for FP32 operations instead of both FP32 and FP64 ops, and a unified cycle instead of higher clocks on the cores. The result is the GTX 680 was similar to the 7970 in gaming, while being a smaller chip at 294 versus 365mm², and it used slightly less power. However, while Tahiti had worse efficiency for gaming, it was leagues ahead of GK104 in general compute performance. In particular, double precision compute, which is vital for many HPC workloads, was excellent on Tahiti. In FP64 performance metrics, Tahiti was capable of approximately 950 gigaflops, while GK104 currently muster 130 gigaflops. It is obvious that AMD's implementation of a compute-focused architecture does not sacrifice much in terms of efficiency. Whereas NVIDIA's previous compute-focused chips needed to be much larger to compete in graphics, Tahiti is relatively efficient when compared to the graphics-focused Kepler, with an overhead on die space of around 20%. Of course, both of these chips were not the biggest within the generation. This title belongs to Hawaii for AMD that powered the flagship 290X and GK110 for NVIDIA that powered the first GTX Titan. These two chips are directly comparable as both are designed to target HPC markets, with GK110 capable of approximately 1.7 teraflops of FP64 performance, while Hawaii had an even more impressive 2.7 teraflops. Hawaii achieved this feat by supporting half-rate FP64 operations, the highest ratio even for a GPU today. AMD implements FP64 performance in GCN within each compute unit and the corresponding SIMs, where they're able to dynamically process FP64 instructions at a reduced rate. This rate is determined by the dynamic hardware scheduler as well as supporting registers for the SIMs, but the transistor or die space overhead for FP64 is small because GCN was designed from a clean slate to be dynamic and different. It was so different compared to Terascale, it actually resulted in a lot of compute apps which worked on Terascale crashing, requiring updates to support GCN. NVIDIA's architectures, meanwhile, are built upon the G80 architecture and CUDA as a foundation. So they evolve over time, so this limited what they can achieve while being backwards compatible. All of NVIDIA's recent architectures feature unique FP64-only CUDA cores, which are inactive for other operations. A large chip like GK110, a third of its CUDA cores actually do nothing for graphics performance and it's just wasted die space. To put this into context, GK110 is 25% larger than Hawaii for what is essentially similar graphics performance while having significantly worse double precision compute performance. At around this time, both AMD and NVIDIA had invested in developing chips for TSMC's 20nm, but it turned out unsuitable for high performance chips and both companies would be stuck on 28nm longer than originally planned. This was a pretty dire time at AMD. The CPU and APU business was in freefall. Despite GCN being a good architecture, it failed to capture the graphics market, while the gains in the HPC market was always going to be a slow uphill battle against the entrenched proprietary CUDA ecosystem. Why did AMD lose the graphics battle with a superior architecture? Personally, I do not believe the theory that NVIDIA's mindshare is so powerful that AMD cannot reach parity to get half of the gaming market. Radeon has a long history, including periods where they were at the top, so it's there for the taking if AMD is able to compete. However, for this GCN generation, AMD destroyed the chances with the worst reference card designs ever. The already hot and loud blower from the 7970 was basically reused for Hawaii-based 290-290X with a much higher TDP to dissipate. Jet engine, vacuum cleaner, and space heater were words to describe how hot and loud they were, and this sunk Hawaii in the eyes of the gaming masses. It did not matter that the throttling Hawaii GPUs traded blows with the much more expensive GTX 780, Titan, and 7080 Ti. Nor did it matter that many custom cards ran cool and quiet, nor that these cards had more VRAM, nor GCN being a more future-proof architecture powering the major consoles for many years to come. None of these selling points matter because the super hot, loud, and power-hungry stigma had stuck and will continue to haunt AMD even today. While AMD self-gold, NVIDIA was pushing ahead. The R&D department, flush with more money, were able to backport Maxwell to 28 nanometers and streamline it for gaming performance. By implementing tile-based rasterization similar to that of the PowerVR architecture on mobiles, Maxwell was a considerable leap in power efficiency on the same 28 nanometers when compared to Kepler. AMD had nothing to compete with Maxwell. They invested in developing HBM, and the experimental Fiji then used bits and pieces from older GCN iterations was all AMD could afford on 28 nanometers. Hawaii was rolled out again, rebranded the 390 and 390X, and asked to compete against a true next-gen leap in Maxwell. Interestingly, Maxwell never had a compute-focused big chip, as the bigger brother to GM204, the mega-sized GM200, was a lean and mean graphics chip. This showed that NVIDIA was willing to diverge its architecture to make graphics and compute-focused chips separately. Why did they not do this before? Simply put, this approach requires a lot of money, as each chip from design to market costs a few $100 million in R&D. The original strategy for these large chips required the expensive Teslas to subsidize the chip for gamers, as AMD competition meant that the gaming GTX variant could not be sold at such a high price to hit required margins. What changed was NVIDIA's efficiency gains resulting in a healthy profit margin for the GTX cards, and NVIDIA had both the money for multi-designs at the same time as the gaming market willing to pay higher prices. However, let's return to the important point here. Even with the advances in Maxwell, and it was graphics focus, Hawaii compares to it very well. The 390X traded blows with the GTX 980 in gaming, and while Maxwell won on efficiency thanks to its tile-based rendering and memory compression, Hawaii won on general compute performance. Yet, chip against chip, Hawaii is only 40mm square larger, or rather, the compute overhead has shrunk to around 10%. Moving on to the latest generation, AMD's Polaris and NVIDIA's Pascal. Since Polaris was designed only for the entry and mainstream segment, the sub-250 market, we can only meaningfully compare it against NVIDIA's mainstream chip, the GP106 powering the GTX 1060. Why shouldn't we compare against the bigger Pascal GP104 or GP102? Because chip scaling is not equal. A smaller chip still has to contain all the basic building blocks as a larger chip, which can pack on more CUDA cores. Blocks such as video output, hardware encoders, memory controllers, interconnects, and non-core as a ratio of the chip size or power impacts a smaller chip more, so comparing similar chips is a fair approach. Consumer Pascal is very much Maxwell tweaked for higher clocks, while Polaris is not much different to Hawaii, though with enhancements to efficiency and tessellation to play catch-up. It's fair to say that the RX 480 and the GTX 1060 are similar for graphics performance. And when we compare the chips themselves, Polaris 10 is 232mm squares, while GP106 is 200mm squares. The difference, or rather, the GCN compute overhead, is only 32mm squares. Power efficiency still favors GP106, typically 120 versus 160 watts, but the power overhead for GCN has shrunk down to approximately 40 watts from the previous 80 watts when comparing Hawaii versus Maxwell. Now, this is simplified because there's differences between models and the capacity of GDDR5 influence power usage as well, but you guys know the point I'm trying to make. Let's play a thought experiment. If we remove the tile-based rendering and memory compression advantage for Pascal, resulting in a larger memory controller bus and higher TDP, theoretically, both chips would be very similar in terms of die space and power efficiency. This thought experiment could also extend to Hawaii versus Maxwell GM204. For all of its focus on high-performance computing features, GCN is an incredible graphics performer. It's even more special when you think about the fact that in DirectX 11 and older APIs, GCN is not even fully tapped. When viewed relatively, GCN is not a jack of all trades, it is very much a master of all trades that suffers in power efficiency compared to recent NVIDIA architectures due to lacking some key features. Now, here's something to ponder on. What happens when GCN finally gets these advanced features? This is where Vega, a revolution for GCN, is going to take it to the next level. But this video, though, has gone on longer than expected, so I'll leave all the Vega talk for the next one. I hope this has been insightful and interesting, and again, thank you for watching.